thanks RSPCA for the invitation to come along and talk about my favourite topic, which is kangaroos. Although the title is Kangaroos and the content will be kangaroos, a lot of what I'll be saying could equally apply to koalas, and it could equally apply to what I consider to be pest species, rabbits, deer, goats and so on. But overabundance to me refers to native species where we are concerned about their numbers and their impacts. So I'll go through that in a minute. I will talk a little bit about concerns that we have about overabundance, but this will be covering ground that Peter and others have covered already. I'm going to spend more time on the causes, what's actually bringing this about, and a little bit of time where we can on cures, how we can actually help to resolve some of these problems. I'll start off just by going through the types of overabundance, and first of all, to stress that overabundance is not just about numbers. It's about numbers and their interaction with impacts, and this is something that Peter covered extremely well. So we are concerned about the impacts, and it's the abundance of animals that get us to that point of impact. There's an old classification of overabundance put forward by Graeme Coulson, a revered ecologist many years ago, and these align very closely with the RSPCA's principle, not quite in the same order, but very similar ideas. First of all, we consider wildlife to be overabundant if it provides a threat to human life or livelihood. That's one category of overabundance. The second one is where the overabundant species depresses other species that we're concerned about, and Phil has covered a number of those. The third one is the only welfare one on this list, the only direct welfare one. This is where the overabundant species is simply too numerous for its own good, so it raises welfare concerns. And the fourth is a more technical point where the kangaroos, or whatever species we're talking about, exceed some sort of equilibrium density. And I'll explain that, and that will take us into causes as well. So we'll have a look at each of these in turn, with some fairly typical examples. First of all, threats to humans. Now these nice looking kangaroos obviously aren't threatening any humans directly. They may be reducing the water level in that dam. They may be browsing on the grape crop. They may be grazing on the pasture and competing with stock. And depending on where you're coming from, these impacts can be seen as severe or pretty trivial. But there are times when these sort of impacts do influence agricultural production. And Stuart explained how that process of issuing permits and is designed to deal with that. Another one that you may not think of as a threat to humans at all, this one I didn't hit better, it was already there. I nearly got here trying to take a photo of it. but we'll talk about roadkill a bit later too, but in this context, roadkill does pose a small but significant risk to drivers. So there are a number of unexplained single vehicle crashes, which the road safety people suspect are either an avoidance of a kangaroo or other wildlife on the road, or in some cases a secondary collision. So they hit the kangaroo, lose control, and then crash into a tree. So it is an issue, and it's an increasing issue in a number of regional areas in Victoria. So it's one we need to think about. This one I'll give you a bit of time to read. This is also a real issue. There are some pretty corny headlines in some of those. The sub-editors seem to take the opportunity to make some bad puns. But you'll see from the injuries to the people that this is a real concern. We understand very little about these incidents. Somebody really needs to investigate these properly. We don't understand cause. One fact that is common to many of them is the presence of dogs. You see the little dog in the middle there. And often the human gets caught up in an argument between dogs and kangaroos. So that's a case of a clear threat to humans. Although unlike crocodiles and snakes, I don't know of any example of somebody who's ever been killed by a kangaroo in Australia. Maybe it'll happen one day. This is the second category where kangaroos or other overabundant species depress other species. And this is another example from the Mallee Parks that Phil was talking about. The particular case is hooked needlewood, one of the threatened woody species, the trees, and you can see adults leaving wood here. This poor old individual is just about on its last legs. It's still producing a bit of seed, but it's just about to die of old age. Inside the enclosure here are the only seedlings of hook needle wood in the entire park. And the background to all this, of course, is the kangaroos. You can see the kangaroo density, and this is just in part of the park, at Hadapal Park. The density increased, the browsing pressure was extreme, and there are no seedlings outside at all. Since then, there's been kangaroo control, quite extensive control, and seedlings are now appearing and surviving outside of these small protected enclosures. That's the sort of evidence that you can see from heavy browsing and high density of kangaroos in some contexts. Another example, depressing favoured species, this is the eastern barred bandicoot, which I'm pretty sure Rachel is going to talk about. This is a threatened grassland species, and the first attempt to reintroduce this species was at Woodlands Historic Park, just out near the airport. A predator-proof fence was constructed around a small part of the park, and the bandicoots were reintroduced to the enclosed area, the protected area. At the same time, somebody got into their head that it'd be a good idea to put some kangaroos in there as well. It was actually part of an experimental grazing trial, but after the trial was over, the kangaroos got out and they then occupied the area inside the protected fence too. This is what the kangaroos did. You've seen graphs like this from film. From 1990 up to 98, the population increased dramatically. And we don't have equivalent data for the bandicoots because they changed the method of monitoring. But in the last 3 years, this is what the bandicoots did. So they had been quite high, and we suspect they've been high for a number of years. In 3 years, they crashed to extinction. That was the major reintroduction effort for this species and the most successful one up to that point. What happened? Kangaroos weren't eating the bandicoots, they're herbivores. What they've done is eat every scrap of grass that the bandicoots depend on for shelter to make their nests to protect them during the day. So the bandicoots probably picked off by birds of prey and maybe just died of sheer terror anyway because they simply couldn't make nests. So that was an example of a very severe impact from an overabundant population of kangaroos. When we get on to welfare, which is what we're really about today, we've seen some unfortunate examples in a number of situations in Victoria. Serendip Sanctuary, you can see here, was looking like a desert. This is out near Lara, this is the side of Geelong. This is the trace of the population increasing, crashed. There was a cull here as well. A bit of recovery, another cull, but the photo was taken at about this time, about the peak, and there wasn't a single blade of grass for anybody. The welfare is something that we argue a lot about how to assess. One way to do that is to look at the reproduction rate. It's not a particularly good method, but it has its uses, and this shows the percentage of females with pouched young in 2007, so just after this peak, and in 2009 after a couple of culls. And you can see that it was less than 20% of females carrying pouched young, which improved up to 50%. But that's only a fairly modest improvement. A normal, whatever that might mean, population of kangaroos could have more like 80 or 90% fecundity. So this was a case of fertility being very severely suppressed by high density and lack of food. And when you think about the effort involved in producing a tiny kangaroo, that isn't a great input that the mother has to make, and yet most of them are unable to do even that. Another way to look at it is one that requires carcasses. That's a body condition index based on the fat around the kidney. It's called the kidney fat index. And it's a measurement of the weight of the kidney and the weight of the fat around it. This one has almost no fat around it, and that was taken in 2007. Around about 3% was the measure there. By 2009, after the culls, it had improved to about 12-13%. But again, that's still very low. An average figure would be much more like about 25%. So it suggests again that this population was under extreme stress unable to breed, unable to deposit any fat, really just barely hanging in there. The other really strong evidence that things were going badly was shown by disease. This was one individual captured. We didn't realise that he was affected until we had him in the hand and could see this big lump on the mouth there. On dissection, there was this massive abscess, and once the skull was cleaned up, you can see the underlying damage to the bone. This disease is well known in captive macropods, and it's a scourge of captive macropods. It's very, very rare in free-ranging macropods. And it's called lumpy jaw, and this population had a staggering 54% prevalence of lumpy jaw. The only other normal population we could find data for was about 7%. So this was massive. So, welfare concerns are real in these overabundant situations. The third one is a little more theoretical, and it's the one that I think is driving a lot of what's going on, so I'd like to spend a bit of time on this. This is where the population gets above some sort of equilibrium with its environment. And this effect is known as a population eruption. You can think eruption, if you like a volcano. It's pretty much the same meaning. And this is the theoretical path that an eruption follows. The population starts in low numbers, it goes through an increasing phase, it then goes through some sort of stabilisation or a peak, it's not stable for very long, it then goes through a decline, which we often call a crash, and then it goes through some sort of post-decline, usually up and down. This is the boom-bust cycle that Phil referred to. It's the essence of it. So over time, the time scale I've left open, this can happen quickly or slowly. The height of the peak and the depth of the crash vary quite a lot, but the basic pattern is the same, and we've seen this over and over. I've actually shown you a bunch of these already. I'll show you one more. This is from Pakapanyal Military Area, a very large area in central Victoria, which has had an ongoing kangaroo problem and an ongoing difficulty in managing it. This shows another one of these long-term data sets, which are very valuable. We've got population scale here. This goes up to 80,000, that peak. And you can see the increased phase with a bit of a dip here, getting up to there. Not a particularly high density by density standards. But then a massive crash, followed by a cull, followed by a series of ups and downs as it's in this so-called phase later. Now, it's worth having a look at the absolute numbers here. This crash represents about 30,000 kangaroos that died of starvation. So we're talking massive numbers.
27,000 kangaroos were culled in Pakapanya that year by the time they died. They were culled.
No, 27,000 were culled here.
In 2002.
It kicked in here, I'm pretty sure. I'll check, but a very large proportion had died before the colour even started.
Yep. We'll keep those questions till the end.
We'll get on to it later.
Yep. It's been misinformation, sorry, man.
Well, we'll check that. I don't want to give misinformation, but that's my understanding. But I know it is difficult because the cull and the mortality haven't been here. But the size of the crash was not accounted for solely by the cull. Those who were there were finding carcasses all over the place, so the mortality was real. So anyway, I'll get on with that later. There are very few camels by that stage. It might have been 4,000. Most of the domestic stock had gone way back here. But anyway, I don't want to get into specifics. We can talk about that this afternoon. Okay, I want to explore why these things happen. The way that populations are regulated, we talk theoretically in terms of two processes. One is bottom-up, which is to do with the underlying production of the system. So in this case, literally, it's from ground level. And that grass has been fertilised, has been irrigated, and it will support a certain number of kangaroos because it's nice green grass. You'll notice, incidentally, that all the kangaroos are over this side of the mowing line, because this grass, although it's green, is actually too short for them to feed on effectively. They're feeding on the slightly taller stuff over here. the sort of species that are involved make a difference, the nutritional value of the species, the grass, and also landscape attributes. So if the area was entirely like that, it would still not be suitable for kangaroos because they need shelter to go and hide in during the day. So you've got to have various elements, but all of those go together to make bottom-up processes which determine how quickly a population is going to grow and how big it will get. But there's also top-down processes, and these are the ones that press down on the individuals by eating them. So Aboriginal people for 50,000 years or so have hunted kangaroos, and they've in up to recent times have had a major impact on populations, we think, although we don't really know. And we also have dingoes. Prior to dingoes, we had thylacines and maybe marsupial lions, who knows. And the point about foxes before is absolutely valid. Foxes are very good at taking young kangaroos, particularly if they are just leaving the pouch. And we have all of these pressures that will keep a kangaroo population down. Somewhere in the middle is where a population actually sits at any particular point of time. It's controlled by the balance of those two factors. So that's what's happening. We've got our top, our bottom up, providing a potential for a particular population to grow, a top down effect to push a population down from where it might otherwise reach. So we then have this underlying pattern that will occur particularly if the top-down pressures are reduced. So we've got the bottom-up applying all the time. Top-down, if we remove predators or reduce predators, then we would expect to see this sort of eruption cycle kick in. It might be less severe, but it will certainly be, that's what will be going on. So how do we actually solve these problems? One way to do it, and Phil touched on this, is to use exclusion. And this has a double benefit, actually. It changes the bottom-up effect because there's less food available for the animals. It also has a direct effect on the impact. So if you're concerned about species in here, then you've protected those. The problem with exclusion is it really only works on a small scale. You can't apply these exclusion fences all over the place. Those who are using exclusion fences to protect threatened species from species like foxes and cats have pretty much reached the limit about how big an area they can protect from those feral predators. And the same sort of thing applies to herbivores. You can't just keep putting fences up over really large areas. There's also a question about maintenance. These fences typically don't last, and there is a necessary investment in actually keeping these running over time. Because as soon as you get a break in the fence, you get animals which will immediately reverse all the good that you might have done. Deterrence. Phil mentioned this a little bit too. This is an old model of what's called a shoo-roo. This is an ultrasonic device you put on the front of your car so you can drive around and be completely fearless at night. That's the Mark II. I think they're up to about the Mark V now, so it's a lot swisher. Cost about $500 fitted. Don't waste your money. They don't work. neither do any of the other ultrasonic devices for reasons I can explain later if anybody's interested. We've done quite a lot of work on these sorts of deterrents. They use different sensors, so there are some that use flashing lights, there are some that use sound like this one, there are some that use scent. They all have potential, but they all need to meet a few essential criteria. One is, is the stimulus relevant to the kangaroo? Does it actually matter to the kangaroo? Can it even hear it, or smell it, or see it? If it is the response that they then adopt desirable? If they simply stand in the middle of the road wondering what that noise was, then you haven't achieved anything at all. So you have to have a desirable response, and the fundamental problem around all of these deterrents is the problem of habituation. Animals get used to things. They get used to almost anything. And if you're constantly blasting them with sound or smell or light, they will pretty soon adapt to it and ignore it. Fertility control, we've talked a bit about so far today. It certainly has its value. This is a female kangaroo about to be given levonorgestrel implants, similar to the koala program. It's worth noting, though, this is an indirect effect on the population. It doesn't reduce the population, or if it does, it's a very long-term proposition. We need more research on long-acting techniques. We don't yet have a long-acting contraceptive for kangaroos. This one lasts 5 years, maybe a little bit longer, but no more than that. The ACT is working on another approach, and we're waiting to see the data on that. But it has to last ideally about 10 years, which would be the reproductive life of the kangaroo. There are all sorts of complications around delivery. At the moment, they're having to either capture animals or dart the contraceptive agent in, but that raises all sorts of problems about delivery. And a really seemingly mundane problem is to do with marketing. You need to know whether that animal has been treated or not. Otherwise, you might just go and treat it again the next week. So some way of identifying these individuals as having been treated already. And that works okay if you've captured the animals, which is a very costly effort, but to do it remotely is much more challenging. Predators. There's been a lot of talk about the reintroduction of predators as a way of exerting a natural control over kangaroos. Wilson's promontory has been suggested as one possibility. There are others as well that have been raised. The good thing and perhaps the bad thing about predators is they operate over a very large scale. So you can't use a predator introduction to protect a small reserve because the predator would need more space than that. But it certainly could work over a large scale. It has a very direct effect on the density because it literally takes animals out and eats them. Probably also has an indirect effect because it would change the behaviour of the prey species. So these kangaroos wouldn't be hanging around looking so relaxed if there were dingoes in the area. But there's a lot of concern about unintended effects. We don't know what effect the introduction of a dingo or Tasmanian devil or various other candidate species might be on other species in the system. And there's all sorts of models and suggestions about which species might increase and which might decrease, but it's unknown. So there are some definite risks there. And we've also talked a lot about culling. This is, to me, a last resort. It has a clear, direct effect on the animals involved. Bill's mentioned in the context of park management. There are questions around its humaneness, undoubtedly. This particular cull, I don't have any concerns about that because it was done under very strict supervision, but the issue particularly of private operators, amateurs, and the way of dealing with pouch young is very much unresolved, I think. I've also, as I said, I consider this to be a last resort. I don't mean by that it should be the last thing you do. In many ways, it might be the first thing to do, as I was sharing in a minute, but it's not what you do unless you've explored other options. So to manage overabundance, I want to just stress this graph keeps coming up. It is the underlying population dynamic of kangaroos, koalas, and a number of other species, just about any herbivore you can think of. And left alone, this is what a population will do. So my take-home messages, I guess, is first of all that overabundance can have multiple effects, and who you are determines what you think is overabundant and what isn't. So from a farmer's point of view, it's very different from someone concerned about welfare, and we need to take all those viewpoints into account. We don't necessarily have to agree with them. These population eruptions seem to be inevitable. They will occur. It's only a matter of time. But left alone, as I say, this is what the population of herbivores will do. And I should also stress that down here isn't necessarily good. We might be tempted to say, okay, they've had their crash, they're now sort of stable. When a population is in this state, it is just hanging on. And it actually becomes very susceptible to external factors, such as drought and floods and cold weather and so on. So it isn't necessarily good to be here. And really, that's my third point. I think that early actions are essential in kangaroo management. I've been involved in far too many places and programs where we've been doing crisis management because we've allowed this population to proceed down this path too long. I'd like to see identification of this potential for rapid growth, boom, bust, if you like, to be clearly everybody's thinking, and to look at intervening here, not here, or here, or here. So I'll leave it at that. And I'd just like to thank a whole lot of bodies and organisations and people who have discussed these sorts of issues with me over the years. They may not always agree, but we've had some very helpful discussions and been to some places, both good and bad, where kangaroos have been the dominant.